All right, Ephesians chapter 6. I didn't tell you that, did I? Should have said that, but you already know that. Somebody asked me if we're going to get finished with Ephesians before the Lord comes. I don't know. Maybe not. If it came today, we wouldn't get finished. Then they said, well, you're going to get finished with Ephesians before you go to be with the Lord. Well, if he comes today, no, but if otherwise, maybe. But we're down to verse number 17, and we're going to continue that today. Father, we thank you this morning for your word and the opportunity to fellowship around it and study it, be instructed by it. We just pray that we have hearts that would be receptive to the truth and then faith to trust it so that it can live in our lives for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. You know, the Bible's the only really coherent, convincing, consistent explanation for why things are the way they are. If you don't embrace the truth of God's Word, your life is never going to be aligned with reality. And you're going to continue to feel the sting of the lies that you've believed. So trusting God's Word, understanding God's Word, is a key element to having what we generally talk about a successful life. And if you want to have your best life now, it'll come because you've trusted what God's Word said. It's the only really consistent connection that you can have with the truth of what life really is all about. We're going to continue looking today at this stuff in Ephesians chapter 6 about our hope, the helmet of salvation, the thing that keeps your head protected in life, the thing that keeps your head in the game so that you're not tossed to and fro. Verse number 12 in Ephesians 6, I just want to remind you about something we've already seen. Verse number 12, it says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Hold your hand there and come back with me to Isaiah 24. When he talks about high places there, he's talking about the heavenly places. He's not talking about, you know, someone talks about you got a high position in government, that kind of thing. He's talking about the principalities and powers and mights and dominions in the heavenly places, in the high places, not just the earthly place. You know that by one of the ways you study your Bible is you compare verses with verse to try to take things and let the Bible interpret itself. It has its own built-in dictionary. Isaiah 24, verse number 20. Isaiah 24, verse 21. It shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall punish, now watch what he says, the host of the high ones that are on high. There's the idea of spiritual wickedness in high places. But what is that? And the kings of the earth upon the earth. You see, when he says the high ones on high, he's not talking about kings and governors and mayors and presidents and senators and that kind of thing. He's talking about location. It's this heavenly host, these high ones on high. That's in contrast to the kings, governors, rulers on the earth. So when he talks about spiritual wickedness in high places, he's talking about that satanic program of rebellion against what God's doing in the universe. Our realm of activity in Ephesians, go back to Ephesians 6 and look at chapter 1. The realm in which believers operate and the realm of interest for believers is those high places. Chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Our blessings, our focus, the thing that God has for the believer are located in the heavenly places. In chapter 2, verse number 6. Chapter 2, starting verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherein he hath loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. You know, sin is deadly. And sin is so deeply ingrained and has so deeply infected humanity not just people are infected by it, but all of the systems that we create to operate. And the only answer to sin is the cross of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, we didn't have it figured out, Christ died for us. If you ever wanted to be valued, esteemed, treasured, loved, there's God's love. If you ever wonder what God, where God is in all this, there he is. Look to, you want to see the love of God? Look to Calvary. That's where God's love is put on historic, objective demonstration. You know, fear is that brooding suspicion that God really isn't for me, that his love isn't going to be enough for what I'm facing, that maybe he's forgotten about me and isn't really concerned about me. And when fear is coupled with self-focus, you take your fear that maybe God isn't for you, maybe you're not, and then you couple that with just self-focus, thinking about yourself all the time, it becomes paranoia. And that's why Paul says God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of sound mind. God's love casts out that suspicion that he isn't for you, that he is sufficient in any circumstance and situation of life. And what Calvary tells you is that everything you'll ever need for life and godliness is there available for you and given to you as a gift. If it wasn't a gift, you couldn't earn it because you'd never make enough to get there. So because you couldn't, God did. So when he says in Ephesians 2, verse number 4, but God who is rich in mercy for his great love when he loved us, when we were dead in sins, when you were unable to do anything, you know, dead people can't do much. In fact, that isn't even right. Dead people can't do anything. And you were dead, unable to please God, unable to even accomplish your own goals on yourself because it always was an illusion and you failed. He quickened us together with Christ. That word quicken, that's a great word. It means to make you alive. But I've said to you many times, you can be alive and just be a vegetable. Quicken means you're fast. It's living life. It's not just I'm alive, but it's life that's active. The Word of God is quick and powerful. It doesn't take God's Word forever to do something. It works when you believe it. And he's quickened you, given you his life. Forgiveness is taking care of the guilt, taking care of the past. But then life. You know, if you've got your past taken, if you're out of debt, that's wonderful. But if you still don't have any money in the bank, you still can't buy groceries. Forgiveness is having the debt paid away. The life part is I've got assets. By grace are you saved. It isn't what you do, it's what he does. Now verse 6, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Our position, the focus of our life isn't downward, it's upward. And that's important to remember that who we are is people who have a destiny. Come with me, if you will, to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15 and verse number 13. We've looked at these verses before, and I'm not going to just go over all the things we've talked about in the past, but I'm going to remind you about them. Because most of you don't remember what we talked about last Sunday anyway, do you? I have trouble remembering it. If I have trouble remembering it, I know you do. It's okay. You can be honest. You guys are sitting there. You guys look like you're at a Texas Hold'em convention. Afraid to show your hand here this morning. You need to get up and exercise or something, you know. You can do some of that. All right, Romans 15, verse 13. Now the God of hope, and that's what we're talking about. We're talking about the helmet of salvation. You're talking about the hope that future hope of glory. This isn't all there is. Right now isn't all there is. There's a future. You've got a grand, glorious future, an audacious future ahead of you. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. You see, there's a confidence that understanding your hope gives you. And it's what gives you the capacity to abound in joy and peace. Living day by day with the joy of knowing circumstances isn't what makes life. Happenstance, what's happening, is, but there's a future. There's something real. And it lets you abound in joy and hope. Get your mind off yourself and onto Him. And we've been talking about the specifics of that, because to say hope, that confident expectation that's an anchor for my future, but what is that hope? And what exactly are the specifics involved in it? Because the more you understand about the specifics, the more the hope takes place, the more the patience of hope can control your thinking process. It has to be based on some sound doctrine. God, the God of hope fills you with joy and peace in believing. Believing some truth, some sound doctrine about the hope. And that's the reason I've been trying to talk to you a little bit about the events that will take place in our future for the believer. Events that shape our hope. Things that are going to take, you know, sometimes we think of our hope, we think the rapture. We mentioned it a minute ago, the Lord coming. That's great. That's when our upward life begins. But you have that eternal life now. So what is your, it's not just the Lord coming. There's a whole series of things that take place after He comes that's important for you to understand. I drew it on the board last week. I was looking at the video, and I couldn't read it on the on the video, because that board doesn't look so bad right now. But if you look at it on the TV, that board is a mess. And so I thought, well, should I write it up there this morning or not? Well, I'm not going to do it. I'll just talk to you about it. But first, there's what we call we think about the Lord's coming. The Lord Himself should descend from heaven with a shout, and there's the resurrection. The first thing that happens in your future when the Lord comes is the resurrection. You get a resurrection body. There's a trumpet sounds at the dead in Christ rise first, we which are alive and remain. So there's this resurrection that you're going to get a brand new glorified body that is equipped for the purpose that God has for you in the heavenly places. So don't get worried about the body you're in now. Now, take care of it as best you can. It's going to get baggy and it's going to get saggy. It's going to do what it does over time. That's part of life. But this mortal body that you're in is not the end result of who you're going to be. When you trust the Lord Jesus Christ, God gives you life in your spirit. You get a new life inside of you. You become a child of God. God is a spirit, and you become able to communicate with Him. You have light in your soul and your inner man and your understanding. You begin to be able to walk in the light of God's Word. The entrance of that Word gives light in your inner man. But your body doesn't get its redemption until the resurrection. It's called the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. And the goal that God has for you is not a dirt sandwich, and it's not to be put to bed with a shovel. The end result for you is to have a glorious body, fashioned like unto His glorious body, to live in eternity, a body that's equipped to do all the things He's going to have to do for you. So He's provided a complete redemption for you. Then at the resurrection, there's what we call the rapture. You're then caught up to be with the Lord. You're not going to be walking around down here. You're caught up, and then you meet the Lord in the air. We saw last time, that's the review. And then you're taken and presented to God the Father for a ranking, an assignment, and then you're going to ever be with the Lord. And when He talks about being with the Lord there, He's not talking about just being in His presence. He's talking about reigning with Him. What's the Lord going to be doing? You're going to be participating with Him in what He's doing in the ages to come. And he's going to exercise His authority. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 7, it says that in the ages to come He might look back at Ephesians 2. You guys are going to sleep. If I don't keep looking at these verses, you're going to be like the baby there. Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2, verse 7, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. That's what your future is about, being a living demonstration of the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. Now, you want that to be a reality now, then it will be a perfect reality. And so you have that future out there in which we're going to be reigning. Now, if you go with me back to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, there was one thing there I wanted to kind of massage a little bit in your understanding. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse number 16. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God. Those three sounds we talked about, those things. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds. So there's the resurrection, there's the rapture, there's our reunion with other members of the body of Christ. Then we go to the review at the judgment seat of Christ. And he says, we're caught up with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And I talked to you last time about that thing about who is the prince of the power of the air? The adversary. So you're literally going to be caught up in the domain of the adversary. Now do two things. Get Jude verse 9 and Daniel chapter number 10. And I'm going to talk with you just a minute about this thing about being caught up into the air. Daniel chapter 10. And this is being a crazy morning. I'm fixing to have to sneeze, so hang on to your wigs. Okay, maybe I can not do it. You're sitting too close. You guys are in trouble. So I just thought about the chalk and it made my nose twitch. Good morning. Maybe we should start over. When you're caught up in the air to be with the Lord, we're going to meet the Lord. That judgment seat of Christ is going to take place in that invisible realm of the air. When it talks about the air, it's not just talking about the atmosphere around the earth. The word air, the term air a lot of times is used in the Bible for the invisible spiritual realm. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9 about beating the air. Well, he's not punching, you know, what do you punch when you punch the gas that surrounds the planet? When you're talking about beating the air, he's talking about there's a fellow I'm trying to hit, and I miss him, and I get over there where there's nothing. And it's a term, when he talks about Satan being the prince of the power of the air, he's talking about he is the prince, the ruler of the invisible realm. What's that? Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, he says, that when Jesus Christ created all things, he created all things in heaven and earth, visible and invisible. There is a visible creation and there is a spirit world that is invisible to the visible creation. And when he talks about the air, he's talking about that invisible realm. You're going to be caught up into the realm run and controlled by the adversary. So when you're caught up there, all of a sudden you begin to say, well, you know, am I going to have to look over my shoulder and watch? Is it going to be safe to walk the streets up there when I get there? Well, Jude verse 9, he says, in 1 Thessalonians, he said the voice of the archangel. The archangel in the Bible is Michael. Jude verse 9, here's the only time in the Bible the archangel actually is heard to speak. And he says this, yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, he disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke thee. Now what that is that, and we studied this last time, what that is when when Satan was trying to destroy the nation Israel, they came out of Egypt, they were baptized under Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and they were the church, Acts 7 says, in the wilderness. And Satan sought repeatedly to destroy them. And then as he does that, God sends Michael to protect them. Michael is the angel, Daniel says, that stands for and is charged with protecting the nation Israel. And Satan, as Satan comes against Israel, Michael doesn't say, get out of here. He did. He understood that Satan was a higher rank than he was. He's a cherubim. Michael's an angel, a higher authority. So he doesn't say, I rebuke you. He says, the Lord rebuke you. And what he does is he calls an angelic army of protection for the nation Israel. Well, the indication then is if at the rapture, when we're caught up in the air and we stay there for the judgment seat of Christ, there is a protective environment provided for us by the armies of heaven. If you come with me to Daniel chapter number 10, here's another place where Michael is involved in that kind of thing. And I want you to, what I want you to see in this is this stuff is real. This is not esoterical kind of, you know, when we all get to heaven, we're going to float on a cloud and play a harp and drink mint julep and whatever it is. You know, I one time I was talking to some people out in Montana, and I made the point. I said, you know, when you get to heaven, you're not going to be catching rainbow trout out of the stream of life. And this lady, she jumped and she said, what? I love rainbow trout. And she actually took me fishing to show me how much fun it was to catch rainbow trout in the streams of Montana. And I said, that's great. I enjoy that too. It was good to eat too. But that's not what you're going to do in eternity. You're not going to be just, I mean, you, as much as it was wonderful as it might be to take a couple of days off and have a little R&R, it would get boring after, sooner enough, eventually, I think, maybe. I had a friend, he lived in Hawaii for 38 years, and he moved back to the States, the mainland. And I asked him, I said, brother, why in the world would... He said, you know, you get tired of perfect weather. I think it'd take me more than 38 years to get tired of perfect weather, but... Such as the eternity probably might would do that. But you're what's going to happen when we talk about going to heaven and the things that we're going to be doing there, you need to understand this stuff is real. And it's not such an unfamiliar kind of an environment. When you read about the heavenly places and you read about what the heavenlies are like, the terms that your Bible uses to describe it are terms that you are familiar with in your daily life. Not because heaven is like earth, but because earth is like heaven. When God created the heaven and the earth, He created all that He created after the pattern of what He was doing. So the earth is made in the likeness of where God lives. You follow that? So when you think about it, when you go to be with the Lord, you're not going to go to some strange, weird kind of environment. You're going to go to a place that's going to be very familiar to you, set apart. Daniel chapter number 10. Daniel is being given visions. Verse number 2, Daniel 10, 2. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 weeks, 3 full weeks. And I ate no pleasant food, bread, rather, neither came flesh or wine in my mouth, neither did I anoint myself at all, till 3 weeks were fulfilled. He'd been given a vision. It so concerned him that he spent 3 weeks praying and fasting. He didn't even take a bath, much less eat. Now, that leaves you in sort of a bad... I mean, if you're so intent that you don't even take care of your personal needs, you've got some focus in your life. Now, in the 4 and 20th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, he begins to get an answer. Come with me down to verse 10. And behold, an angel comes and talks to him, verse 11. And he said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee, and stand upright. For unto thee now am I sent. And when he had spoken this word unto me, I stood trembling. Now notice what he tells her. He said, I've come to give you understanding. Understand the words, and stand up. I've come to give you some understanding, and I've come to give you the ability to stand, give you some strength. So he's going to give him some communication that's going to fortify Daniel. Verse number 12. And he said unto me, "Fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set thine heart to understand and to chasten thyself before thy God, thy words were heard, and I am come for thy words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. But lo, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, and I remained there with the king of Persia. Now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days, for yet the vision is for many days." Now think about what he's saying. Here's the angel Gabriel. Daniel prays and says, "I got this vision, Lord. Send me the understanding." In chapter 9, he'd already done this once. And Gabriel had come and given him information. Now Daniel gets another vision, and it bothers him. "Lord, help me." So the Lord from third heaven sends Gabriel down across the universe to the earth with the answer. Okay? He says to Daniel, "It took me 21 days to get here." Now think about that. Should it take an angel 21 days to get across the universe? Well, no. They do that all the time. Why did it take him 21 days? "The prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me." Now think about that. That means out there in the universe, there's a kingdom. The kingdom of Persia, it's called. If you're going down to the passage, you talk about the kingdom of Greece. Now those kingdoms had comparative kingdoms in the earth. If you look back at verse number 1, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a thing was revealed unto Daniel. So Daniel is in the third year of the Persian kingdom. And yet there's a kingdom. If you can understand, there's a kingdom on the earth called Persia. Gabriel said, there's a kingdom in the heavens up there called Persia. And he said, God said that after Persia, the Greek Empire is going to come. Daniel's already got that information. And Gabriel says, not only is there a kingdom of Persia, there's a kingdom of Greece up there. Now, if you can understand how there can be a kingdom on the earth called Persia, he uses the same identical terminology to describe a kingdom in the heavens, in the angelic realm. So when he talks about the organization and the structure of the heavens, he uses terminology that describes an organized geopolitical situation. Where does that come from? Hold your hand here in Daniel. Come with me to Colossians chapter number 1. Colossians chapter 1. Colossians 1 verse 16. The heavenly places are real, they're organized, they're occupied. And the occupants of the heavenly places are not friendly to the things of God. Or they wouldn't have tried to stop Gabriel from coming. So there's things to learn about these places. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. For by him were all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth. That's the only logical explanation for the reality that you live in. Is that in the beginning, God created. If you can't get those five words right, you'll never get anything right. The great philosophy, the great worldview of the scripture is different from the worldview of man. Man says, "I'll create my own reality." How's that working out for you? Well, if you're young, you think, "Well, I can do it." You get older, you look back and says, "Well, I missed the mark." In the beginning, God created. When you look at the facts of creation, that's the only explanation that meets the facts. Either the facts of philosophy, the first cause, or the fact of science, the laws of thermodynamics. That's reality. If you don't like it, it doesn't change it. Now, the conflict is that people don't like God to be God. They'd rather be God themselves. And the great lie of the adversary, Romans chapter 1, verse 25, is that men take the truth of God and change it into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator. To make yourself God, to make your will the supreme issue in life, that's the lie. And when you believe the lie, the sting of the result of that lie will be a part of your life. And when you reap the sting of death, that's where it comes from. But the truth of God's word is, in the beginning God created. Now, it's interesting to know what he did and how he did it and why he did it. But you've got to know he did it first. Colossians 1:16, for by him, and that's Jesus Christ, for all things created, that are in heaven and that are in earth. Now notice what they are. Visible, you can see them. Invisible, you can't see them. Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, or powers, those are positions of government. So he didn't just create a physical, natural universe. He created a government to run that universe, to orderly, you know what the word cop, C-O-P means? It's an acronym. It means constable on patrol. And the chief duty of a constable on patrol is the orderly maintenance of his precinct. The orderly maintenance of society is what government's job is. And it's accomplished through principality, thrones, dominions, principalities, powers. All things, all these thrones, dominions, principalities, all these governmental authorities were created by the Lord Jesus Christ and for him, created to carry out his purpose. See, when he created it, he had a purpose for it. When you make something, you have a purpose for it. Verse 17, he is before all things, because he's God, and by him all things consist. The reason it all holds together is he's got a plan, he's got a purpose, and it's held together by the word of his power. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things, all the positions of governmental authority, he might have preeminence. Now, he had a plan to have preeminence in the things in the earth. That's why he made Adam of the earth earthy. And he told Adam, go out and restore my authority over planet earth. Adam failed. Adam joined the opposition. God told him, I'll come and do for you what you couldn't do for yourself. And he promised the seed of the woman, who became the seed of Abraham, the nation Israel, and ultimately the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's going to provide a redeemer and then a redeemed people to reestablish his authority in the earth. It wasn't until in the Bible, until you come to the ministry of the Apostle Paul, that you found out that God hadn't forgot about the government in the heavens. He had a plan to reconcile the government in the heavens. And that's what the church, the body of Christ, is about. That's why we are a separate entity from the nation Israel. Because God's plan is not just to reconcile the earth, but to reconcile the government in the heavenly places also. Because just as there's a government on the earth, there's a governmental structure up there. And it's just as he uses exactly the same terms to describe the heavens that you can't see as he uses to describe the earth that you can see, so that you can understand what you can't see by looking at what you can see. That's why I said, when you get there, it'll be a familiar environment because it'll be something that reflects what's here. I just want you to see they're organized. Been organized all along. Occupied by creatures that God has put there to execute his will. And yet there's been a rebellion. Because you go back to Daniel 10, and when you do that, you realize that there are some some principalities and powers, some angelic creation up there that aren't interested in God's will and God's word being carried out. Revelation 12, he talks about Michael and his angels and Satan and his angels. There's been a rebellion in the heavenly places, just like there's a rebellion in the earth. Come with me for the book of Revelation, chapter 12, chapter 19, just a second. Revelation 19. When you realize that that the heavens are and the earth are divided up into these, we call them geopolitical divisions in the earth, well, then there are geopolitical divisions in the heaven. There's the kingdom of Persia, the kingdom of Greece, and so on and so forth. When you realize that they're real, organized, structural entities, and that they've been usurped by the adversary, and that God has a plan to reconcile them back to himself, and you and our participation in that is going to be to establish his kingdom in the heavens, just like Israel does on the earth, it helps me. And if it can help me, it can help you, because, I'm dumber than a post most of the time, and you're not, right? I'm not. Are y'all awake? You don't look like it. You're with me, yeah. You're not with me very enthusiastically. I wait all week to preach to you, and then you sit there. You know, the chair is just set there. Yeah, okay. I know it's overwhelming, overpowered you, and you're having to think about it, and the cogitations of your head upon your bed are, no, anyway, Revelation 19. Watch what happens. Just watch how this works. Revelation 19:11, and I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him, called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he to judge and make war. Notice, when the Lord Jesus Christ comes back, he's riding a horse. Now, if I know anything, I know there's a whole bunch of you that like horses. Now, think about the fact that in heaven there are horses. Come with me to 2 Kings chapter number. Hold on to Revelation. Come on to 2 Kings chapter 6. Now, just think about what that's telling you. I'm not worried. I'm not so much interested in the war. And if he comes on a horse, and by the way, in verse number 14, Revelation 19:14. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses. So it isn't just that he has a horse. He's got an army. And they've all got horses. And not only that, you got 2 Kings chapter 6. Okay, hold on to that. Look at Psalm 8, Psalm 60, 68. This is a stream of consciousness here this morning. Psalm 68, verse 17. The chariots of God are 20,000, even thousands of angels. Now think about that. He's got horses, he's got chariots, vehicles. Do you have a car? Do you ever need new tires? You ever have a tire fall off? No, you hadn't. Well, that's good. My granddaughter sitting back there, she has. It's an exciting thing to be riding down the street and look around and your back tire is passing you. Ask Kayla, she can tell you about that. If you've got those things, they require maintenance. Where do you keep them? Where do you keep a horse? Put it in a stable. Do you know what you do when a horse is in a stable? Well, now this is the way it is here. I don't know what it's like up there. But if you've got a horse in a stable, every now and then somebody's going to have to. Right? There's maintenance. You know what there is? It's life. Now, he uses terms that you understand. Horses, chariots. You understand how that means there's an ecosystem of life going on here. And there's an ecosystem of life going on up there that's like this one. Now, I don't know if angelic horses, you know, make manure. But if they do, some of you are going to wind up shoveling it. Well, he says you're going to reign with him. And if you're one of those names that are, you know, every name that's named, see, there is a real motivation to move up the ladder at the judgment seat of Christ. It's real, folks. This is not just make-believe. 2 Kings chapter 6. Elijah is being assaulted. He's got his servant, manservant with him. They see all these people coming after them. Verse 16, he said, "Fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them." And the guy looks at him and says, "Elijah, what are you talking about? It's just you and me, and look at all them troops coming." And Elijah prayed and said, "Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountains were full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elijah. He opened his eyes so he could see into that invisible spirit world. What did he see? He saw horses and chariots of fire. The horses weren't made out of horse meat. You ever eat horse meat? Well, see, you go like that. There's lots of people in the world eat it. I've actually been in places where I ate it. Not in the U.S., but in other places. You get hungry enough, you'd eat most anything. But their flesh is made of fire. But he calls them horses. Now, my point to you is that there's life, recognizable life there. Go back to Revelation chapter 19. Here's another one, verse number 14. "And the armies which were in heaven followed him with upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean." Now think about that. You know what linen is? Linen is a cloth made out of a plant. So you had to have somebody grow the plant. So there got to be farms. Alex was talking a moment ago about Ridge Farm. You go down, if you go south of Chicago, the other Illinois, farms, Illinois is flat as it's that floor, and farms, thousands of acres of farmland growing crops. If you're going to make linen, up there in that spirit world, they're farms. Now, if it's real, if it's like what's here, I don't know what it's like up there. Hadn't been. I'm going to enjoy getting a tour and working in it. But my point to you is that what's here is what's there. Psalm 78, he talks about angels' food. And he says that what God fed Israel in the wilderness, manna, was really angels' food. You know what they drank? Dr. Pepper. What else would you want to drink with manna? But if you have angels' food, somebody had to harvest it, cook it, serve it. When you think about what are you going to be doing in heaven, there's work, there's business, there's an economy, there's life to carry on. And by the way, it says that linen garment, you grow the linen, you process the linen, you weave it into cloth, you make a garment, you take it over here and you fit it to somebody, and then it says it's white and clean. You had to clean it. There's a laundry up there. Oh, my goodness. See, there's motivation to move up the scale of economy. But there are all these jobs, these functions, these things that are real life. And that's where we're going. You're not just going to go nowhere. You're going to go into a familiar environment where there are things to do to be accomplished and carry on the business of God, carry on His purpose in His creation. Now, If you come back with me to, well, you're in Revelation. Just look at chapter 12, because we're going to run out of time. Chapter 12. And get 1 Corinthians chapter 6. The original plan of the adversary, Satan, he was created perfect till iniquity was found in him. The iniquity, the crookedness that was found in him, had to do with he wanted to take over that government. He wanted all that government and all the occupants of it to worship him and to carry out his will, that is, of exalting him. He wanted to use the structure that God had created and populated with creatures designed to worship and honor him. Satan wanted them now to worship and honor him and use the structure in the heaven and the earth for his purposes. God had a plan to restore that back unto himself. That's why Colossians 1:20 says, having made peace through the blood of his cross, to reconcile all things, all those governments, unto himself, whether they be in heaven or earth. So through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, he wasn't intending just to save your miserable soul from the misery of your sin. It was that, because the next verse says, and you hath he reconciled through the body of his flesh through death, that he might reconcile you that are enemies in your mind by wicked works. You participate individually in this because you trust Christ. But having trusted Christ, you're made a part of this great cosmic plan that God has to exalt the glory, the treasure that is in his Son. Revelation chapter 12, this stuff comes to a head. We talk about the tribulation period, you talk about the Antichrist. All of that is just bringing, you know, there's so much in the scripture about that short little period of time, the 70th week of Daniel, what we call the tribulation. The reason there's so much in the Bible about that short period of time is because that's when the battle is decided. I'm not a fan of basketball. Never was. Some of you love it, play it. I never did. But not being a fan of basketball, I learned early on that really in a basketball game, what do you really need to watch? The last 2 minutes. It takes about 20 minutes for the last 2 minutes to get played because now you're down to the nub of it. And in basketball, the last 2 minutes are what actually counts. In football, you actually have the 2 minute warning. Well, the tribulation is the two-minute warning. It's the last 2 minutes. And right in the midst of that, Revelation chapter 12, verse number 7, there was war in heaven. And Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. That's Satan and his angels, Michael and his angels. Now we're going to have a war between these guys. You only thought war took place down here. Satan and his angels, and they prevail not. Neither was their place found anymore in heaven. Notice, he literally takes Satan and his angels out of their places of occupation. They get fired. They get thrown out. In the terms of Numbers 33, they are dispossessed. He literally takes away and throws them out. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceived the whole world. And he was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So all of those occupants in the heavens up there, Satan and his angels, are cast out of their positions, down to the earth. You get them in a cluster so you can come and get them all in one place. And I heard a loud voice, verse 10, saying, in heaven, now, in heaven, is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. So at that point, the kingdom of God is established and the whole government of the heavens is now under God's control. Verse 12, it says, therefore rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth. You know who's dwelling in the heavens now? We are. You know who's in those places that were occupied, that were vacated by Satan's host? We are. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. When he says we're ever going to be with the Lord, we're going to reign with him in the reality of that life in the heavenly places and carry on the various functions that need to be carried on to make that life, those national entities, operate. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 2. We'll start in verse 1. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? The question is here is, if you've got a dispute with a brother or sister in Christ, should you go over there to lost people and let them decide it, or should you go to other believers and let them decide it? Don't you as a believer have some instruction that gives you the ability to answer and solve conflicts among the brethren? Don't you have that wisdom? Well, you should. Do you have that maturity? You should. Now, here's how he challenges them. Don't you know, do you not know, that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world should be judged by you, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matter? You've got a big job of judging, discerning, deciding ahead of you. Can't you do the small ones? Know you not that we, the body of Christ, shall judge, notice, angels? How much more things pertain to this life? Your destiny, you're not going to do this now. You know, I know, guys, your wife, you think she's an angel. Try telling her what to do. I've been married 51 years. I know how successful you are with that. These are real angels. Guy said one time, said, how's your wife? She said, oh, she's an angel. He said, well, I'm sorry, when did she die? That's not the kind of angels we're talking about. Your destiny as a member of the body of Christ is to participate in the government of the heavens, just as Israel on the earth. There's more to your future than just floating on clouds and playing harps. Now go back with me to Daniel, because I want you to see why this is important to understand. Daniel 10. Get Daniel 10 in one hand, Deuteronomy chapter 20, and hold on to Ephesians 6. Daniel 10. Verse number 11. Daniel said, here's why Daniel needed to know about this. He said unto me, O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak unto thee. So the first thing you need to do is have some understanding. Verse 14, now I am come to make thee understand what shall befall thy people in the latter days. He wanted him to know what was going to happen. What does God have in store? Verse number 21, I will show thee that which is noted in the Scripture of truth. Notice, where was Daniel going to learn what he needed to know? The angel was going to point out what is noted. You see the word note is past tense? In the Scripture, that's what's written down. He said, I'm going to show you things out of the Word of God that are going to intelligize you about what your future and the future of your people is. Now, when you get informed, enlightened out of God's Word, what does that do? We'll go back to verse number 11. O Daniel, a man greatly beloved, and understand the words that I speak unto you, and stand upright. In Luke 13, there's a little lady, and she's bent over, been that way all her life. And she comes to Christ. She's like this. And he heals her, and she can stand up like that, straight. And I think about that. Here's a little lady. If you're bent over like that, what are you looking at all the time? Think about that. It's a picture of the way the nation of Israel was, a picture of mankind. Just looking at the dirt. Couldn't look heavenward. He says, stand up. I'm going to give you some information so you can stand upright. You can see what's out there. You're not going to be focused on yourself, on your failures. You're going to be focused on what I'm doing. Now, if you come down to verse number 20, then said he, knowest thou wherefore I come unto thee? And now, no, I need verse 19, I'm sorry. Daniel 10:19. And said, O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be unto thee. Be strong. Yea, be strong. And when he had spoken unto me, when he gave me the words, what happened? I was strengthened. You see that? First he's enlightened, then he's empowered. If you go to the book of Ephesians, Paul prays two prayers in the book of Ephesians. The first is that you might know him. And that you might be filled, that he would grant you the spirit of wisdom and the revelation of the knowledge of him. Your eyes being enlightened. Now once that happens, the enlightenment, the knowing. Do you understand today your Christian life won't operate on the basis of ignorance? The average church you go to today in the evangelical world, much less the mainline denominations, you can go there for your whole life and never learn how to study God's Word for yourself. You know that. That's why you're in a place like this. You go up in the average church, you can just screw your head off and leave it in the glove compartment. You won't need it till you go out and lock it up because you're going to need it when you leave. But you won't need it in the church because it's just all stuff. Mindless rituals. Paul said, I want you to know some things. Why? The other prayer. That you might be strengthened by his spirit in your inner man. First there's enlightenment, then there's empowerment. That's what knowing these things does. And the reason for that, if you go back with me to Deuteronomy chapter 20, just an illustration real quick. It takes moral courage to win a war. You need staying power. You need troops that have that patience of hope, that ability to stay in the battle, to keep your mind on where it needs to be, keep your head in the game. God told Israel, Deuteronomy 20, fascinating passage about the life in Israel. Verse 1, when thou goest out to battle against thine enemies and seest horses and chariots and a people more than thou, be not afraid of them. For the Lord thy God is with thee, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. So when you look at circumstances, you're going to go out and fight. Don't judge it based on what you see out there. Understand who you are. And it shall be when you shall come nigh unto the battle that the priest shall approach and speak unto the people. So what you need is the Bible teacher comes and he begins to teach sound doctrine to the troops. And say unto them, hear, O Israel, ye approach this day unto battle against your enemies. Let not your hearts faint. Fear not. Do not tremble. neither be terrified because of them, for the Lord your God, he is he that goeth with you. So before they go into battle, they need to get some sound doctrine filling up their hearts. Moral courage, spiritual courage, comes from sound doctrine filling your soul. The God of peace fill you with joy and peace in believing. The God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing. You've got some sound doctrine in your heart that you understand, that you know, that you trust. And that spiritual courage that's necessary for the battle courage comes out of that. Now, when we talk about the helmet of salvation, what are we talking about? We're talking about putting on the fight, putting on the helmet. I'll try to show you those last pieces, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation. So that's, you pick them up because we're going to fight. We're not just being who we are with the girdle of truth and breastplate of righteousness and the shoes. We're not just understanding who we are. Now we're ready to get into the battle and to fight the good fight of faith. Apply the doctrine in the conflict. And the courage that it takes to say, for to me to live is Christ, only comes from having an understanding in your heart of who you are, understanding some sound doctrine in your inner man, being filled with that truth, letting that truth grip your understanding so that you can live for something worth living for. You can live for something that lasts forever. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is to cherish who He is, His plans, His purposes, His thinking, His viewpoint, more than mine and more than anyone else's. The courage necessary to stay in the battle and to have battle courage at the moment when you have to apply the doctrine in the struggles of life. That sound doctrine, that helmet of I know who I really am, that's where it comes from. So in the battle, we have high hopes. They're heavenly places hopes. When you understand who you really are, you can spend your life for something that's worth spending it on, something of eternal value. It's real, folks. The whole point this morning is it's real. It's wonderful to explore it, know about it, understand it. I was talking to someone just the other day, and they love Monticello. You know where that is? George Washington's place. And they can tell you all about it. And ad infinitum about it. I appreciate it, but there's a lot of stuff I didn't ever heard about. But you know, you get fascinated by something and it controls you. And when your fascination for me to live is Christ, and be fascinated with the reality of what God's plan in Him is, and your participation in it. That makes a difference tomorrow when you go, this afternoon when you go, today, this morning when you go, and you have to face the challenge to take the truth of who you are in Christ and right now live in that reality and say that's more valuable than anything else. So if you want to have battle courage, you have to have the moral courage, the spiritual courage that comes from sound doctrine, keeping your head on straight. And that sound doctrine is what the God of hope fills you with when you believe His plan and purpose in the Lord Jesus Christ. If you've never trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, by the way, personally, I'm not talking about religion. I'm not talking about just going to church. If that's all it was, I'd quit. I recommend people quit religion. I'm talking about having a personal relationship, a living relationship, with the one that created you. The way you have that is by trusting His Son. He loved you enough to send His Son here in His love, not that we loved Him, but that He loved us and gave His Son to be the fully satisfying payment for our failures so He then could give us His life. You don't need to go anywhere, do anything, move a muscle, pray a prayer, make a deal. You just need to trust what God's done for you. You need to look at him and say, Lord, I can't save myself. And I don't want to die and go to hell. That's the consequences of your sin, hell and the lake of fire. And that isn't what I want. I don't want my life destroyed by my sin. I want your life. And you trust him to be the Savior who died and rose again for you to be. God will save you. If you have a question about that, there are people all over this room that can help you out of an open Bible. If they can't, they can get you somebody that can. But you don't need us, you need him. We just want you to understand it. Father, we thank you this morning for life in Christ Jesus, for the hope that's ours, for the future that you've planned to honor your Son. We give you the praise for it in Christ.